shining star. No matter who you are, shining bright. You can truly be what you can truly be.
Oh, in your heart and soul. I don't hesitate, cause the world seems cold.
Stand your ground.
Rooted in faith, rooted in love, rooted in pride and tradition, the roots of the African American community have been firmly planted, providing an unwavering anchor for our people. As we venture into the 21st century, we must also root ourselves in research connecting our past and present by deepening our understanding of the world in which we live. We invite you to connect with us for the empowering webinar series, Rooted in Research. During this month-long series, the Delta Research and Educational Foundation, Black Greek Letter Consortium, Cobb Institute, National Panhellenic Council, Delta Teacher Efficacy Campaign, University of Alabama, and other member experts will explore the intricacies, power, and influence of dominant issues concerning our community. Research is continuous and impacts our daily lives. Research builds knowledge, facilitates learning, increases understanding, spreads public awareness, aids in building success, finds, gauges, and seizes opportunities, and provides an avenue to expose lies and amplify truth. Out of a sincere desire to educate our communities, DREF Research Matters and the Black Greek Letter Consortium are committed to provide a platform to address topics and share educational and relevant information with large audiences of individuals who represent the underrepresented populations of the United States. During these uncertain times, this show of unity throughout our communities is an effort to shift knowledge and perspectives related to all components of education, empowerment, health, and wellness to those who can benefit. Collectively, we will plant seeds of knowledge in mental, physical, and financial health, as well as grow our understanding in the power of community service, social action, education, and mentorship. Celebrating while educating, the Rooted in Research webinar series is committed to strengthening the African American experience.
Good evening. My name is Darrell A. Anderson, and I am the International Executive Director of Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated. Additionally, I'm a program coordinator for the Black Greek Letter Consortium, the hardest working healthcare strategies intervention team this side of glory. My job tonight is to introduce you to an integral and important program. Most of you are asking, what is the All of Us Research Program? Well, let me tell you. The All of Us Research Program is a historic and innovative program designed to gather 1 million participants to create a database for clinical research. This program strives for a database encompassing of volunteers of all backgrounds with a focus on minority or underrepresented populations, just as the video stated. This includes communities who have been historically had insufficient representation in medical research, such as African Americans, Hispanics, Asians, Native American, and people with disabilities, et cetera. So what is the Precision Medicine Initiative and why is it important to us? Why is it important to us as a people? Well, this program was created as a result of a Precision Medicine Initiative, PMI, announced during the State of the Union address on January the 30th, 2015, by the 44th President of the United States, President Barack Obama. President Obama stated that doctors have always recognized that every patient is unique, and doctors have always tried to tailor their treatment as best as they can to us as individuals. You can match a blood transfusion to a blood type, which was an important discovery. What if matching a cancer cure to our genetic code was just as easy or just as standard? What if figuring out the right dose of medicine was just as simple as taking our temperature? During President Obama's administration, the Precision Medicine Initiative was launched to advance the acceleration of biomedical research in precision medicine. Precision medicine is defined as an emerging approach for disease treatment and prevention that takes into account actual individual variability in genes, the environment, lifestyles, and other things that are considered socioeconomic for each person. It can be summed as individualized healthcare based on the factors that make us different, that make us unique. Some basic examples of personalized medicine include prescriptions, prescription glasses, insulin use, hearing aids, or other things which are tailored to the specific individual that is using it. Currently, most medicine is designed for the average patient with a one-size-fits-all approach. This may work for some, but not necessarily for all of us. So if you've ever taken any type of medicine that didn't sit well with you, the odds are it probably was not a good fit for you in the beginning. Precision medicine is taking an innovative approach to the things that make us different and unique, using those factors toward disease prevention and treatment. So what's our role as the Black Greek Letter Consortium, the BGLC, in terms of the All of Us Research Program? Well, this group is comprised of the 9 historically Black Greek Letter organizations, read that as Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated, and the governing body of the MPHC. And they have united to promote the importance of precision medication and participation in clinical research. We recognize instances like the Tuskegee syphilis experiment and the Henrietta Lacks story, and they've caused distrust in the Black community and resistance towards getting involved, with us getting involved specifically. We use this knowledge as a driving force to develop campaigns, policies, and opportunities that would uplift and support Black people in our country through each organization's national president, our social media, and our on-site activities at various events. We are working together. We're working in unity to help generate the diverse database of volunteers needed to get to that 1 million goal or more volunteers. Why now? Why are we doing this right now? Well, now more than ever, with the disproportionate number of African Americans dying from COVID-19 pandemic, we're steadfastly working to make sure that all are represented for clinical research. Now, that was just the appetizer. At this point, I'm going to introduce 2 significant people, and I'm going to start with our international president of Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated, Brother Michael Crystal. Michael Crystal's hometown of Grenada, Mississippi, is where he launched his storied career. He attended, and he will tell you again, I'm sure, Mississippi State University, where he worked to get his Bachelor's of Finance degree. Now, he was elected the 35th International President of Phi Beta Sigma on Thursday, July the 20th, 2017, during our conclave in Detroit, Michigan. Brother Crystal has an extensive resume. I'll keep it short for you. He's been the Southwestern Regional Director, the International Director of Social Action, the International Director of Bigger and Better Business, and the International First Vice President of our fraternity. He is currently the Vice President of Operations for the Kroger Company in Phoenix, Arizona, where he's responsible for leading a team of 22,000 employees within 122 Fry's stores in Metro Phoenix and Tucson. Brother Crystal and his wife, Marcia, have three children, Lauren, Brandon, and Jalen. He coined his administrative theme of Phi Beta Sigma fraternity being a brotherhood of conscious men actively serving their communities. And this certainly applies to our important area of education. At this point, I bring to you our international president, Brother Michael E. Crystal.
Thank you, Daryl. Thank you for that introduction. And to our audience, thank you for participating in the All of Us engagement series centered around knowledge is excellence. Certainly excited to have you join Phi Beta Sigma this evening as we promote knowledge is power then and now. You know, Malcolm X once said, education is the passport to the future, for tomorrow belongs to those who prepare for it today. This is the current state of our education systems in the United States. The COVID-19 pandemic forced schools to close, impacting more than 56 million K through 12 students. These closures led teachers to transition their classroom instructions from in-person to digital formats to reach students at their respective homes. The conversion occurred at a rushed pace, and the challenges that emerged created opportunities to reimagine our approach to education and supplementing our students' learning needs. Social distancing orders made virtual education the safest option to teach children. As we embrace technology's role in enhancing students' education, we must navigate the inequity of the digital divide. Some students are unable to fully engage and benefit from virtual learning because they lack the necessary resources to effectively participate in virtual classes. Research has shown the disparities in digital education are greater in underserved communities compared to wealthier communities. Identifying solutions to bridge the digital divide requires collaboration between key stakeholders. Phi Beta Sigma recognized narrowing the digital divide gap in education by focusing on three key areas. Number one, ensuring every student has access to essential equipment, such as computers and tablets. Recent data from the National Center for Education Statistics indicates that 17% of children ages 3 to 18 lives in households without a laptop or desktop computer. At least 11 million students do not have a computer for online learning, and if they do, they may need to share the device with their siblings. Number two, increasing affordability of high-quality internet services for low-income homes. The NCES findings show 14% of children ages 3 to 18 don't have internet access at home. More than 9 million school children will face difficulty completing assignments online. And 34% reported not having internet because they were unable to afford it, and 4% because connection was not available within their area. We know that lack of access to home internet or a computer is higher for lower income students. And thirdly, increasing digital literacy for students as well as parents and guardians. In addition to providing access, we must help parents and guardians and students understand how to effectively utilize the technology, analyze information, and collaborate with others virtually. While addressing the technological needs of digital education, we must consider the human element. We must address our mental health and enhance our coping skills to deal with the increased stress caused by the coronavirus pandemic. To that end, Phi Beta Sigma took steps to empower and uplift our members. Some of the things we did included, we enhanced our Living Well Brother to Brother program, which partners with community groups and healthcare institutions to reduce the incidence of health conditions that adversely affect men of color through education, screenings, civic networking, and activities to encourage healthier living. We hosted an international call that provided brothers facts about COVID-19 and best practices to stay safe. We hosted our Sigma Wellness Engagement Series, consisting of four webinars that provided brothers knowledge and skills to help them lead their families and communities through difficult times. We hosted a virtual happy hour during the month of April and May that entertained brothers and provided opportunities for brothers to connect all across the country. And currently during the month of May, we're hosting a virtual interfaith spiritual engagement program to provide brothers with space for spiritual reflection and opportunities to connect with spiritual communities. Tonight, we talk about education. We uplift, we celebrate education. And throughout the month of May, we will celebrate our graduating seniors, whether they're collegians or our alumni brothers who could be very well pursuing higher degree diplomas as well. And so as I approach our mirrors, the work done by the state of New Jersey is to incorporate social emotional learning, or SEL, into the classroom. SEL helps increase emotional competence and social skills among students by focusing on five key areas: self-awareness, self-management, responsible decision-making, social awareness, and relationship skills. These competencies matter because research shows children exposed to social emotional experience have less emotional distress, exhibit fewer conduct problems, and are at lower risk for drug addiction. Some ways to facilitate SEL could include talking openly with students about managing their emotions, encouraging students to reflect on their own progress, help students practice mindfulness as a strategy to manage emotions and keep calm, discuss empathy with students and provide ways they may consider other people's feelings, teach students how to create SMART goals, teach students coping skills and stress management, teaching students actively listening, helping students practice respectful disagreeing skills, and lastly, encouraging activities that allow students to express themselves creatively, such as journaling or crafts. In addition to facilitating classroom activities with students, educators must regularly assess the school's climate and resources to determine effectiveness and identify areas for enhancement. Effective implementation of SEL is an enterprise best achieved through collaboration between key stakeholders. Though today is filled with a tremendous amount of uncertainty, as a Brotherhood of Conscious Men actively serving our communities, we have a blueprint tonight that we will share with you that will absolutely help us prepare for a promising tomorrow. Now more than ever, we must be steadfast in our dedication to equity. We must be steadfast in our dedication to accessibility. And yes, we must be steadfast in our dedication to sound educational practices. This pandemic may have slowed the pace of life in our country, but make no mistake about it, it has absolutely fast-tracked us towards the future of our education. And so tonight, we have great discussion from all of us that will really set the stage, because we know together, we will embrace tomorrow by, more importantly, preparing for our future today. And so I'm excited tonight to have Dr. Repelet, who is currently the Commissioner of Education in New Jersey, but I'm also extremely happy to have Brother Anderson to introduce Brother Repelet as we navigate this conversation. Brother Anderson.
Thank you, Brother Crystal. Thank you, Brother Crystal. You know, a lot of people say, hey, how did Phi Beta Sigma end up with the topic of education? We don't often hear Black men talking about education, but we should hear more about it. And it's integral to Phi Beta Sigma. Why? We were founded on a Black campus called Howard University by a Black man who was from Memphis, Tennessee. So education has always been important to Phi Beta Sigma and always will be as one of our international programs. Now, I'm excited about what education has done and will do. And I'm going to give you a perfect example in just a moment of how this works in today's world. Our guest speaker tonight is Brother Dr. Lamont Repelet. He is currently, and I say currently, the New Jersey Commissioner of Education, and he's overseeing the top rank public school system in the United States. Now, from 2014 to 2018, Brother Dr. Repelet served as superintendent of the Asbury Park School District in Jersey, where he helped increase the graduation rate by 30%. Earlier in his career, he served as a high school principal and a teacher, and we all understand what that means. He's about the business. Dr. Repelet graduated from King University with a master's degree in educational administration in 2000 and served on the King Board of Administration, King Board of Trustees from 2011 to 2018 before assuming his role as commissioner in 2018. Oh, but wait. This past Monday, May the 11th, following a unanimous vote, the Board of Trustees of King University announced that Brother Dr. Lamont Rapalett will become the 18th leader of King University. He will serve as the president of the university. I don't need to say anything else. I'm going to let him say everything else. Brother Dr. Lamont Rapalett, the table is yours.
Brother Anderson, I appreciate it. Thank you. The coronavirus has brought personal and professional challenges none of us has ever faced before. It has tested our resolve, but Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated teaches us during unprecedented times, we must reflect on the meaning of our motto, culture for service and service for humanity, and believe in the value of perseverance to overcome any challenge with grace. As a fraternity, we leverage our positions of power to extend a ladder to folks less fortunate through brotherhood, scholarship, and service. If I found any wisdom or solace through my leadership of the New Jersey Department of Education during these turbulent times, it has been because of these fraternal values. That's why it's important to me to participate in this conversation today. I firmly believe that only by redoubling our commitment to these values can we rise to the unprecedented challenges of COVID-19. Schools are a community. In every school building, teachers, counselors, nurses, coaches, aides, cafeteria staff, maintenance staff, administrators, and countless others joined together to watch over our children. Unfortunately, coronavirus disrupted that community. It has closed the places that our kids usually go to receive personal guidance from their favorite teachers, mentorship from their coaches or the Sigma Beta Club mentor advisors, fellowship with their friends, two hot meals and emotional support. Schools play a critical role in our kids' lives that goes way beyond learning just math and reading. I am not sure we have fully grasped all that consequences of widespread school closure. But I do know that we must meet these challenges head on. Educators are working around the clock to keep the school communities alive through remote instruction, food services, counseling, mental health supports, and other critical services. As best believe, our families are doing heroic work to nurture our students during these unprecedented times, turning their homes into classrooms, having tough conversations with our youngest kids about what all this means, and while coping with the impact of coronavirus on their own personal and professional lives. Those sacrifices will enable us to weather this crisis. But as an educational policy leader, members of the Phi Beta Sigma fraternity and the Divine Nine community, I have responsibility to use my position of power to uplift our neighbors, our neighborhoods, to address the impact of school closings. We all do. We must look especially hard at our neighborhoods most impacted by the coronavirus, our Black and Brown neighborhoods, our urban centers, and our southern rural communities, our families. This will be no easy task, and as a state leader, I understand the deep and profound impact the coronavirus has had on our country. I speak with other educational commissioners and state leaders across the nation almost weekly to assess the national landscape of remote educational system. Educational impact of COVID-19 is most evident in the instruction of our children. Students are accustomed to in-person guidance and attention from their favorite teachers, but now must switch on a dime to completely different learning modes or modality, all while juggling whatever their home lives throw at them. This adjustment has particularly challenging for the students with disabilities, English language learners, students experiencing homelessness, and countless others who rely on their schools to provide individualized supports. These inequities have plagued our educational system long before COVID, but this transition to remote learning shines a particularly harsh spotlight on gaps in access to educational opportunity. There are still too many students who cannot participate in virtual learning. We must continue to work with the federal government, foundations, legislators, corporations, and local districts to increase access to every student to make sure that they are connected. It must be said though, that even if we put a device and internet connection in every child's hand, learning requires more than access to virtual instruction. It requires students and educators to feel safe. Beyond ensuring access, we must find ways to meet our community's social and emotional needs. Our students deserve to continue receiving the accommodations, behavioral support, social and emotional support, and mental health services that make learning possible. This pandemic will cause adverse child experience for some students, and we need to address those traumas. We must talk to our students about the public health crisis, not to scare them, but to make them aware and informed and give them the ability to express their own anxieties. We can't forget that our teachers and parents deserve the self-care necessary to ensure that we are physically, emotionally, and mentally capable of being there for our children. Teaching while quarantined can be a stressful time, and it is imperative that parents and educators take the time to reflect and release all of the stress and tensions from the week. We all must pay attention to how we are feeling, make time for self-care, exercise, or perhaps surround yourself with a virtual support group in the event that you need to vent or even share a few laughs. Sometimes our mind and our bodies just need a break. Meditation, mindfulness, and other replenishing activities such as yoga, long baths, and walks are a great way to let go of the pressures of the day. Just to know that you are never alone in this, we need you to continue holding the minds of the future. So when I think about the role we play in addressing these impacts, I think in terms of the three P's: policy, practice, and performance. Our policy are the rules that we run our organization by. That enables us to give our schools and families what they need to meet these unprecedented challenges. Our practices are how we build a culture within our organization that respects the constituents we serve and that projects an image of compassion, understanding, transparency, and receptiveness to community needs. And our performance is how we measure our success, objective data to reveal how we are actually serving our community and serving our kids. I encourage our community and local organizations to think critically about how you can leverage your organizations, the three P's, to fill the gaps left behind by school closure. Let's talk about policy. At the state level, we have pursued a number of policies to help address these impacts. Our guiding principles is to ease the burden of state requirements in order to allow schools and communities to focus every resource on their students' most pressing needs, especially now. We're hopeful that these actions will empower districts to stay laser focused on coping with and recovering from the effects of COVID-19. Our practice, when it comes to practice, my state has taken a boots on the ground approach to respond in real time to issues raised by our schools. We work with every county office to gain real time insight into issues around the state and provide targeted support. We had to revamp our practices to fit the needs of our times. Through these practices, my goal was to build a culture of responsiveness and transparency to the school community. Organizations like such as yourself must adjust their practices to meet the ever-changing needs of our society. You can't have a previous system that was relying on brick and mortar to a new system of remote learning. You must adjust and change that system accordingly. And if we make the proper adjustments to our practice, then we will see the results in our performance. We cannot stop working until every student and family has equitable access to the high quality education and support services they deserve. We are responsible for our students' education, so we must create and provide the programs that they need and advocate for their continued success. I encourage everyone to think about how to wield your three P's. The coronavirus has taught us that education is truly a community effort. School and parents and nonprofit organizations, corporations, local organizations, Divine Nines, they must come together and collaborate on the needs of our students more than ever before. So how do you or your organization fit that community effort? How can we leverage our resources to elevate that community effort? As policy, perhaps our brothers, our state education directors and others could provide feedback to local school districts on how they could be accommodating our most valuable parents and students at this time. Perhaps our brothers with access to childcare opportunities can open their doors. As practice, perhaps we could, as a fraternity, use our state and local chapters to survey our community's most pressing needs. Perhaps we can push our resources and information for all the other support services our brothers offer through the organizations they are involved with. And as performance, perhaps we can measure our touch points in the communities, measure how families, our resources serve, measure our presence and how it most impacts the communities. Whatever we do, our guided principles must be used, our tools to serve others in deep and meaningful ways, to add ourselves to the patchwork of organizations working together to uplift our families. Our communities need to know more than ever and be equipped to meet this challenge with grace. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much to Mr. Chris Dow, as well as Dr. Repelette and Mr. Anderson for starting us off with a bang and all of this amazing information about education on today. We're going to bring up Dr. Joy Bradley, an assistant professor from the University of Alabama College of Community Health Sciences, and she's going to share about education, research, and the All of Us Research Program. Then we're going to come back and do some Q&A.
Awesome.
Education is often used as a proxy for social economic status in the field of public health. We know that there's a direct correlation between high education levels and better health outcomes. This becomes a problematic relationship when we consider the inequities in education and health outcomes of minority populations. Health literacy is also becoming an education issue as we consider how people navigate the healthcare system to achieve optimal health. For instance, one's education directly impacts their ability to make informed decisions on medical treatment options and fully comprehend medical brochures and consent forms. All of us can help illuminate the relationship between education and health and give researchers a better understanding of the effects of health literacy on health outcomes across the different regions of the United States. We're going to go to questions from the audience. And the first question is about the digital divide. To the panel, what is the leadership of Phi Beta Sigma fraternity recommending as an aggressive action plan to narrow the existing digital gap in education on a national basis?
So I can jump in here. We're seeing a number of innovative approaches to getting students connected. Districts have purchased individual hotspots for students, have solicited donations of hotspots from organizations, borrowed hotspots from local libraries. So you can see that it's been, a community approach. But also we see that it's not just a digital divide in regards to technology, but it's actually the access of internet. And I think that across the country, we've seen a variety of approaches. Different communities need different solutions. In some urban centers, we see that buses are even equipped with wireless internet. And guess what? They have buses available for students to get on that bus in densely populated neighborhoods during school hours. So guess what? They can actually have virtual instruction. In the rural settings, communities have banded together and took the pressure providers by expanding infrastructure. So we're seeing that there has been a vary in ways of approaches. One size did not fit all. So as we start to think about and think outside the box, when I talk about the system we had before, we automatically went from brick and mortar to remote learning. So therefore there is a gap. There's a learning gap. There's an instructional gap. So we need to make sure that as we look at the digital divide, we need to make sure that our kids can use the technology to be able to, and to make sure they have access to the internet. So these are some of the things that from a national standpoint and best practice that's going on in the country.
Thank you. Thank you for the answer.
Yes, amazing answer. Lots of practical things to pull out. And I think it's also perspective shifting for many because, you know, the reality for everybody is not the same. So someone may not even understand that whole digital divide. They might not understand that access piece, you know, because they have access. So thank you so much for raising that up because that's a big conversation and a narrative as we try to press forward, getting people, you know, prepared to do the tech piece, but also not forgetting about those that are getting further left behind because of the digital divide. So thank you so much for that. The next question is about mental health and stress. Since many of the Phi Beta Sigma fraternity members are educators, What are methods they are using to recognize the symptoms of increased stress during COVID-19?
Well, it's kind of challenging doing this remote learning access to kind of touch and put your hands on our kids. So that's why it's important that we do these wellness checks, you know, reaching out to individuals, because as we start to get back to the business of student learning, we need to also look at the whole child. So when we start to talk about removing those barriers and really talking about assessments, now we're talking about the needs of our kids. So therefore, we need food security. We're talking about just checking in, self-care. So our students and COVID-19 during this time, we must talk to them and be able to express their feelings and talk about this, because you're going from every day having that contact with their friends and that social development to the fact that now they're in their own homes. And some homes may not be the most pleasant homes. So it's very important that we look at the self-care aspect of, reach out, do wellness checks to individuals, chime in. When you have virtual Zoom classrooms, have enough time to have a social Zoom classroom as well. Instead of just the reading, writing, arithmetic, make sure that they have a time to just talk and socialize, right? Do, so in New Jersey right now, we currently do, we do a New Jersey Learning Live, which we partner with a television station. And we also have a gym teacher, a physical education teacher, come in and they do yoga and do exercise and tell kids, let's run around and dance. All those things to make sure that the kids are not just buried in the access of learning, remote learning, but yet thinking about them holistically, touching and reaching out to them, a wellness check, but also making sure physically they're well too. So there's a lot of things that people are doing, but the fact that we are focusing on social and emotional, especially in New Jersey, is key for us, because as we talk about the reading, writing, arithmetic, we also must put in the stress levels as well. Because anxiety during this time, whether it's through the parents, our students, it's extremely high. So we need to make sure as an organization, whether it's through our Sigma Beta clubs, make sure that all our Sigma Beta club advisors are doing checks, calling in. They have telephone numbers. Mom, dad, can I speak to my mentee? How are you doing? Have virtual game night. So it's up for us to continue to actually reach out and touch our kids. And you know, we can't touch them physically, but touch them virtually.
Yeah, if I could piggyback on that, I'm sorry, Chris.
Yeah, if I could just kind of build off of what Dr. Repelet said, you know, he gave great insight from the academic perspective, but I want to just draw attention to what he spoke to earlier and I kind of reinforce. You know, during this environment, we got to really make sure that we're uplifting the individuals, the parents. And you heard me talk a lot about so many of the COVID-19 awareness seminars that we were doing, all centered around now parents, our brothers, many out here in this audience, you are basically teaching your students, teaching your kids. And so we've got to make sure that we're providing real good insight to them to minimize stress so that they can connect with the kids in a meaningful way. Recognizing that there might be some challenges. We talked a lot about socioeconomic challenges. We talked a little bit about a transition around the digital divide. But what can we do to provide relief and stress to our members? And we spent a lot of time really reaching out to members who have that level of educational training, professional training. And the more we can do that, we tend to believe the things that Dr. Repelet talked about in respect to connecting with the students, it's easier for those parents to deliver for that. And we know as we prepare for the fall, to a large degree, our parents are going to have to do a significant amount of that teaching as well. And so we've got to be prepared mentally for it. Darryl, do you want to add something else?
Yeah, I want to, and I certainly appreciate where we were going with the conversation, but I want to add a little bit if I can. I certainly applaud what we're doing on that K-12 level. But it is important to understand that a significant part of the population was displaced during the coronavirus process. And that's our collegiate members, those who are going to college. So when we're talking about health and wellness, we're also talking about not just reaching out to those who are on high school campuses, but you need to reach out to those who were in college. This has been very disruptive to their lives. And I'm so appreciative of Phi Beta Sigma because we've launched the Sigma's Got Soul campaign. And it simply tells us, hey, they're brothers, yeah, they're grown men, but they were displaced. They're having some issues. We know that a lot of self-deconstruction occurs when you get into college. And a lot of times we think that they have it all together, but they're still formulating what they're doing as well. So Phi Beta Sigma has stopped and said, we're gonna reach out to everybody. We're gonna check on our collegians. We're gonna support them because we don't know. Just like we were talking about, there may not be internet in the home for high school students. Some of these guys are freshmen and sophomores. So that same home that didn't have it for the high school guys, they don't have it for them either. So we got to put resources in their hand too. So I applaud my organization for taking into account that we are a family and we're going to reach out to our collegiate members just as well as we're working with our high school students and middle school students.
Okay. Great responses. So the next question is about the future of the education process. The question is, how does Phi Beta Sigma fraternity recommend that educators across the country effectively use the SEL information that was introduced for the state of New Jersey?
Well, if you want, I could jump in this and we talk about that. So those core competency areas that we talked about early, pretty much you can go across any, whether it's K to 12, whether it's higher education, but it's important more so that we really just look at the humanistic approach towards individuals. Because, you know, other states may not have, and New Jersey is fortunate enough to really have these standards, but other states may not. But if you just look at the whole, just the whole child itself, right? I think that's how we can actually reach across. We have a lot of organizations that really touch within our organization, a lot of clubs and activities. We can actually touch our kids to make sure that that their social and emotional is being addressed. Now we introduce some sound structures. However, we need to make sure that everyone, their parents, because we noticed that it's not just SEL for parents, because there's a lot of frustrated parents out there right now that are doing remote learning. So how do we combat that frustration? Because we understand that that frustration can actually go down to our kids. So I think that's from our standpoint, from a K to 12 standpoint.
Okay.
Great, great answer. And I love how I've heard you say the whole child a couple times. And I think that's very important because we have to always come through that lens, especially now, because you also spoke about ACEs earlier on when you were talking about SEL and the traumas. And in this season, we know that traumas are just all the more increasing, knowing that we were already at a very high state before this crisis. So I think us understanding that and educators understanding that, even if they don't go back person to person, in a brick and mortar, right? Even engaging digitally in virtual spaces, we have to keep these same mindsets and perspectives at heart when we're dealing with the children. So we appreciate you bringing forth all of the SEL information as well as the ACEs information and the trauma, because that's our reality. Our children are suffering and some of them don't even have the words to express what they're feeling. Think about it, some adults don't. So we know the babies don't. So really, really thank you for that. The last question here we're gonna take for this evening is, how does Phi Beta Sigma fraternity envision the process of providing high quality education for students change for the better part in our post COVID-19 area?
So I can honestly say no one knows exactly what education will look like across the nation after the pandemic, because we've never been in this situation before. But I do know it's very important for organizations such as fraternities and sororities to really step up to make sure they can fill in the gaps. So like New Jersey is one of the hardest hit states, but our educational community is resilient, creative, and innovative. We're seeing that right now. And across the state, we're seeing teachers going above and beyond and stepping up and being innovative. I mean, actually at a dime, they're going from brick and mortar to remote learning without even the training, right? Our parents are stepping in and seeing that. So you're gonna see the fact that A, parents are now appreciating the students and the teachers now, right? Because at home, they have to deal with their child. And when, especially when a child's in a confined space and their anxiety is running high and their frustrations are high as well. So we don't know, but I do know that we're in the process of creating a recovery framework that provide guidelines to districts throughout the state of New Jersey, but we're also working in partnership throughout all of the states through the Chief Council of Chief State School Officers, which are the commissioners and state superintendents across the state. They're looking at a recovery framework in such areas such as continuity of learning, condition of learning. What type of school are we gonna have? Based off the health guidelines, we may have kids do staggered schedules or A, B day. So we don't know exactly what it is. And it's all predicated, honestly, on the conditions of the health conditions of our state or the states or the country to actually determine that. Because that'll determine, do we go to 100% remote online because the health restrictions are kind of heavy? Or do we ease up a little bit and have in-person instruction? However, we have heavy social distance restrictions, or do we ease up? So those questions will allow us to be able to determine and dictate what type of educational model we're going to have. But I can tell you, education system will not be the same, because now we just realize that we can actually go to remote learning. However, if we have time to plan, we can use that towards our advantage during snow days for the northern states, so in hurricane days for some states, so we can kind of continue that learning. So I look forward to really working with my organizations, with the state organization and the different fraternities as a state leader to really address those issues, but more so filling the gaps, because when we assess what happened after this, that will give us enough data to really go back. We talk about that performance piece, right? The measure to find out exactly where we're going to go with our school system. So it's going to change, but I do know that the Divine Nine, our organization, especially Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity, we're going to continue to be an integral part in our communities. We're going to continue to be a loving partner with our parents, and we're going to continue to mentor our kids, and not just our students, but also our collegiate brothers as well.
You know, if I could just add on to what Dr. Repelet said. So when you think about what's been happening as a result of this pandemic, I always like to use the word force because we knew that there were some opportunities for more engagement of parents. And so as educators and the school system, I know students are gonna come back with parents way more involved. And we know as a result of that, that's gonna elevate educational attainment. We also know that when we think about our fraternity and many of our D9, we spend a lot of time providing scholarships, and that's good. But what we're gonna really learn from this pandemic is intimate involvement with the development of our students are going to be more needed as we go forward. So when you hear Dr. Repelet talk about the work that we're doing with our Sigma Beta Club, we know that we're going to accelerate that engagement, but we also know that we're probably going to have accelerated engagement of parents. And so with both entities working in collaboration, we know that that's going to be a better student. And so as we think about the tough times of the pandemic, the different experiences that we're having, It's challenging creativity, it's challenging innovation. And we know collaborative between service organizations like Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity, institutions like our school system, both working collaboratively, we know we're gonna see a student that's a little bit more engaged with some huge rewards on the other side. And so negative, maybe now, but a tremendous amount of positive forthcoming. And I think that's the part that we gotta really look forward to.
Yes, that's amazing. I like how you shifted our minds to look as to where we're going, right? Not to be stuck in our present, but be, you know, have the knowledge of our present, but also to start casting vision and looking forward as to where we're going so that we can be well equipped for that. So we thank you for that. So now, President Crystal, we want to just give you this opportunity to bring any type of summary to this conversation.
Absolutely. So when you think about this evening, number one, we certainly want to be very thankful for the opportunity to collaborate with all of us. We want to certainly have an opportunity to celebrate the partnership with our Divine Nine. And really a huge compliment to Dr. Repelet. I hope this audience saw great depth of knowledge. I hope they saw a tremendous amount of passion that he has for really uplifting and educating our students. And hopefully Keene University should be extremely proud about the leader that they have forthcoming because he's gonna make a huge impact on that university. And so as we think about tomorrow and we think about how we connect with our students better and we think about the digital divide, our hope is we've shed some light around the relevancy of connecting with students in a more meaningful way, respecting the impact of this pandemic, but more importantly, really thinking about how do we advance and accelerate our engagements for our students on tomorrow. And so hopefully you enjoyed the session this evening. Like every session, there's always an opportunity for an ask. And the huge ask is you're gonna eventually see a link on the screen, and we would certainly welcome your engagement on filling out the survey. Our whole goal is how do we make these webinars more engaging, more impactful, and we're gonna ask for your support on providing that. So again, thank you very much for the partnership. Thank you for your participation. And we certainly invite you to continue to participate in these webinar series as we migrate through the rest of the month. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, President Crystal. So you should be seeing soon a link where you can go to the survey to complete it. There's a bit.ly link there. If you're looking on your computer and you know how to use the QR code, you can simply hold your phone up and get to it that way as well. So please go continue to work on that survey. And we really appreciate you for completing that to help us fine tune and elevate these messages all the more. Again, thank you to each of our distinguished panelists. We really are appreciative of the knowledge, the wisdom that you brought on this evening in regards to education, because education is truly key. DTEC Tag, we stand on education. It's a heart matter. And we felt your passion this evening, and we're grateful, grateful, grateful. So please make sure you tune in next week for our webinars that will be led by Alpha Kappa Alpha, Alpha Phi Alpha, and Iota Phi Theta around mentorship, financial health, community service. And make sure that you share out what's going on this Rooted in Research series. Get people to come through with us next week. All of the replays are back on the page. You can come back and watch them and share them out. Now, special announcement. We talked about the virtual Greek party on the last webinar. We want to actually share it again here because we want you to tune in, and we also want you to upload your dance videos. The information on each of the organization's social media sites. So you can go there and find the flyer that tells you what to do. You can still upload, and it has been extended through later tonight. Upload and use your hashtag, use your songs, and come be with us on Memorial Day as we continue to lift education, continue to lift everything that we're doing, but also lifting up the 2020, the graduates as well from all over the nation. So anybody, this is open to anybody. This is for collegiates or alumni. Please, please, please take a look and join us for that event. And also we have some tech tips here at DTech Tag. Check out our social media platforms. We're in this digital space, this virtual space. Don't be afraid of the technology. We have some resources over there to help you with some tech tips that's very easy for you to implement. Note that this series is for everyone. I hope that we're getting this word far and wide. Bring a sorrow, bring a friend, bring a friend, bring a family member, and share out. And we'll see you next week for the continuation of Rooted in Research. Now, enjoy some additional information about the DREF and BGLC collaborations.
For nearly 3 years, DREF Research Matters and the Black Creek Letter Consortium have collaborated to engage our communities through education and awareness events, initiatives, and programs. These efforts promote the need for inclusive research, creating opportunities to reduce health disparities affecting African Americans. On behalf of DREF Research Matters, BGLC, the National Panhellenic Council, and our partners, thank you for joining us for the Rooted in Research webinar series. Please take a moment to complete the Rooted in Research survey by scanning the QR code that appears on your screen or entering the bit.ly link into your URL. You can also access the survey by clicking the link in the comments. Feel free to send questions regarding this webinar or requests for additional information to rootedinresearch2020@gmail.com. To learn more about the All of Us Research Program and its benefits for our communities, visit www.joinallofus.org/DREF.